Hello, today we'll be talking about thermal burns. These are our learning objectives. You should be able to understand the different types of burns and their classifications, assess the severity using various criteria such as depth, extent and location, as well as familiarizing ourselves with the management of thermal burns including the airway and fluid components. You should also be able to assess and manage a patient with thermal burns and identify the factors necessitating transfer to a burn center. This is what we will be covering in the presentation. Introduction. Burns can occur in any age group, in particular, the first few years of life and those aged 20 to 29 years. Serious burn injuries occur most frequently in males. They can be classified into 6 different types based on the mechanism, such as scalds, fire, contact burns, chemical, as well as electrical and radiation. The mechanism varies with the age group, and for today, we'll be concentrating on those due to scalds, fire, and contact. This is the structure of the skin. It has 3 layers, namely the epidermis, dermis, and the subcutaneous tissue. The outermost layer is the epidermis, which consists of stratified epithelium, and the stratum corneum forms a barrier which protects the skin from infection. The dermis consists of the papillary dermis, which is more superficial, and the deeper reticular dermis. This layer contains an extensive vascular and nerve network communicating with the epidermis. The subcutaneous tissue is composed of areolar and fatty connective tissue. It contains skin appendages, sweat glands, as well as sebaceous glands and hair follicles. Now we move on to assessing the severity of a burn. Burns can be classified by their depth as well as by their size and extent. Let's start with looking at the depth first. There are 3 types of burns. Superficial or first degree burn, in which only the top layer of the skin, which is the epidermis, is affected. A sunburn is a common cause. It usually appears red and is extremely painful. Blisters are not formed and 2-point discrimination is intact. Superficial burns usually heal without scarring in a few days. In a partial thickness burn, both the epidermis and the dermis are affected. This may be caused by splashes from hot liquid and blisters are characteristically present. They can take anywhere from 2 to 6 weeks to heal. And in this type of burn, a portion of the epithelial appendages remain, thus they are able to heal the skin without having to perform a skin graft. However, deeper partial thickness burns have less viable epithelial appendages and are more prone to hypertrophic scarring. In a full thickness burn, the epidermis, dermis and subcutaneous tissue are destroyed including the capillaries and nerves. There may also be involvement of deeper underlying tissue like the muscle and bone. Flame and prolonged immersion are possible causes. They have a white, leathery appearance with occasional charred areas. Despite being more serious than superficial burns, they do not cause pain as the nerves are damaged. A skin graft is required for full thickness burns. Other than assessing the depth, we also look at the size and extent of the burn in assessing its severity. The rule of 9s, as shown on the left, is the most easy to remember, of which the head is 9% of the total body surface area or TBSA burned, the front and back torso are 18% each, the upper limbs are 9% each, and the lower limbs are 18% each, with the perineum taking up 1%. The patient's palm, including the fingers, is 1% and can be used to estimate irregular or scattered burn. In a child, the head is allocated 18% while the legs are 13.5% each. Another common method is to use a Lund and Browder chart as shown on the right. The percentage allocated is slightly different, but it allows for greater variation between different age groups. Having learned how to assess burns by depth and size, we can now proceed to categorize them according to severity. Someone is likely to have a major burn if it is a partial thickness burn more than 25% of the total body surface area in an adult less than 50 years of age, or more than 20% in children younger than 10 and adults older than 50. Anyone with full thickness burns involving more than 10% of the TBSA or any partial full thickness burn involving special locations such as the face, eyes, ears, hands, feet, and perineum are also classified as having a major burn. Other factors include extremes of age, presence of comorbidities, inhalational injury, as well as onset of infection. Major burns are ideally managed in a specialized burn center. Moderate burns include partial thickness burns of 15-25% in adults, 10-20% in children or older adults, and they generally require admission but do not need to be transferred to a burns unit unless special locations are involved or there are comorbidities. Minor burns include superficial or partial thickness burns less than 15% in adults or 10% in children and older adults. Full thickness burns less than 2% may also be classified as minor unless involving special locations, and minor burns are usually managed as outpatients. In many instances, good first aid and pre-hospital care can significantly reduce ongoing damage and improve outcome in burns patients. The first thing to do is to ensure that the patient's airway, breathing, and circulation are stable and resuscitated as needed. In particular, we should look out for signs of inhalational injury such as singed nasal hairs and sooty sputum. Oxygen should be administered if available, and if a person exhibits signs of shock, elevating the legs may be of use until intravenous fluids are commenced. Remember, people don't usually die of a burn injury immediately, and what kills them is the airway compromise or associated trauma. The main treatment of the burn skin itself may be remembered as the 4 C's: cool, constrictors, cover, and consult. First, cool the burn under running water for at least 10 to 30 minutes, and remove the heat source at the same time. The temperature of the water can be anywhere from 1 to 5 degrees Celsius or even room temperature, but use of ice or ice cold water is not advisable due to frostbite risk. It is also important to monitor the patient, especially if large areas are cool, as he may become hypothermic. The second C stands for constrictors, or more accurately, to remove those constrictors. Objects such as rings and bangles can act as tourniquets upon the onset of edema, constricting the limb and compromising distal circulation. This is notwithstanding the fact that they are even more difficult to remove when the swelling sets in. Lastly, cover the damaged skin to protect it and reduce the risk of infection, and consult the appropriate doctor or hospital specialist. Now we move on to management in the emergency department. First, stabilize the patient's airway, breathing, and circulation. It is necessary to intubate the patient if airway compromise is expected. For circumferential burns of the chest, an escharotomy may be required. Intravenous fluids are also administered early, as shock may ensue. Establishing the severity of the burn will allow us to decide on the appropriate disposition, cool the burn if not done earlier, and then administer tetanus vaccination if not up to date. Dress the burn and cover all partial thickness burns with antibiotic ointment such as silver sulfadiazine. Whether or not to debride intact blisters is controversial, but it would be logical to do so for blisters located in areas at high risk for rupture. Provide adequate analgesia and decide on the best area of disposition based on the patient's severity. In some burns victims, inhalational injury may occur in the context of a fire. This may include upper airway swelling, acute respiratory failure, as well as carbon monoxide poisoning. Upper airway obstruction may result from edema 12 to 24 hours after the incident. As such, early intubation is advised in patients with suggestion of upper airway injury, such as orofacial burns, sooty sputum, and stridor. Fiber optic bronchoscopy may aid in the assessment of the airway. If there is an eschar of the chest that limits respiratory excursion, escharotomy is performed. Lateral incisions are made in the anterior axillary lines that extend from below the clavicle to the 10th rib, and these two lines are then joined to form a square across the anterior chest. If respiratory failure occurs, mechanical ventilation may be necessary. And in carbon monoxide poisoning, administer 100% oxygen to increase the elimination of the carbon monoxide. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy may also be considered, especially if the person is acidotic. Other than airway issues, another area to look out for will be the fluid and nutritional status for those with major burns. Fluid losses can be significant, causing reduced intravascular volume and shock. The Parkland formula is a common method of calculating fluid requirements in the first 24 hours after a burn. Hartmann solution is a common crystalloid that is administered. The Parkland formula is calculated using formulas of crystalloid multiplied by the percentage total body surface area burned multiplied by the weight in kg. Half of this fluid is given in the first 8 hours, with the remaining given over the next 16 hours. This fluid includes that given prior to arrival in the hospital and should be taken from the time of injury. It is also important to monitor fluid status by various measures such as the urine output, with at least 0.5 ml per kg per hour of urine in an adult. These are alternative formulas that can be used to calculate fluid requirement. The Galveston formula is used in children, as the Parkland formula may underestimate fluid losses. Burns patients are typically in a hypermetabolic state, which can be as high as twice the normal metabolic rate. Caloric requirements are calculated using the Curary formula, and dietitian referral should be considered with early enteral feeding initiated. Remember to initiate stress ulcer prophylaxis and maintain blood sugar levels within acceptable limits, as with any severely ill patient. Dressings for superficial and partial thickness burns are those which can provide a moist healing environment, such as the off-site dressing. This results in decrease in surface desiccation and eschar formation, And also, it is less painful for the patient due to decreased frequency of dressing changes, as the dressing may be transparent, allowing for ease of wound inspection. For full thickness burns, early excision and grafting is advised. In summary, we have learned how to assess burn severity, which depends on various factors such as depth, extent, location, patient's age, comorbidities, as well as the mechanism of the burn. Burns can be classified by their depth into superficial, partial thickness, and full thickness. The size can be estimated using the rule of nines or the Lahn and Browder chart. The management includes securing the airway, breathing, and circulation, as well as the four C's, which stands for cool, remove constrictors, cover, and consult. Supportive treatment with tetanus vaccination, topical antibiotics, analgesia, and appropriate disposition is vital to the successful recovery of the patient. Major burns should be transferred to a burn center, and early intubation with adequate fluid resuscitation should be considered. Thank you.